Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness.
The reading today comes from the book of Hebrews, chapter 8, from verse 7 all the way to verse 13. For those who are old enough, when growing up, we used to have this telecom booth. Right? We used to have this telecom booth, and whenever you had a need of making a phone call or a telecom phone, rather, you were required to go to a designated place where you would find that booth, because it was like permanently fixed in a certain place. So you could find people queuing, waiting for their turn to make calls. And when the other person you are anticipating to reach on the other side is not available, you would have to wait. And sometimes you would receive information from other people that so and so alikuwa amepiga na amekuambia atakupigia tena maybe saa 9 na dakika 10. So it was your responsibility to ensure that saa 9 na dakika 10 uko pale kwa booth, kwa maana kwa upande wake atakupigia. And this telecom booth was the technology of then. It was perfect. It accomplished its work. But this was not the end of technology, because it pointed us to another better technology to come. This day we have the cell phones. You have your smartphone. You are able to reach your loved ones or whoever you want instantly, at any time, anywhere you are. The telecom booth had no problem. And so this day we are starting of a better covenant that we have. A better covenant. The book of Hebrew, we don't know who the author is, only God knows. But as to whether the book is inspired of the Holy Spirit of God, it is of no doubt. The early church fathers and the reformers could not agree who the author of the book is, but they did not question the intention of the one who authored this book or the integrity of the word that it contains. He is writing, whoever who wrote this book, under the influence of the Holy Spirit. He was writing to Jewish Christians who were on the verge of leaving their Christian faith and go back to their Judaism. Because of persecution, because of problems that they were facing then. And in chapter 1 of the book of Hebrews, the author begins by telling us, or by lifting Jesus Christ higher than any other person or any other thing. God at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets. He has in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. is writing this letter to people who are facing persecution and problems, and they are on that verge of leaving the Christian faith, this better new covenant, and go back to Judaism or the old fashioned law that was given to Moses. And in chapter 8, it begins by telling us, now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which the Lord pitched, and not man. So verse 1 and 2 gives us a sum of the things that he has been arguing or telling them previously in other chapters. So we have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. They know of an high priest who serves in the earthly tabernacle, because them being Jews, they understand the language of high priesthood system that served under the order of Aaronic priesthood system. And this they understand very well, that it came by the law which was given by God to Moses himself, being the mediator of the old law, or the old testament, or the old covenant. The old covenant in itself, it has no problem, because the old covenant, it was to serve the purpose of pointing them to a better covenant, which Christ himself fulfilled when he died upon the cross of Calvary. The old covenant in itself, it has no problem. It is served to expose their sins, but it could not solve their sin problem. It was perfect in its way, in its own time, but it had an expiry date. And so, in verse 1, who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens? So we have one high priest who is seated somewhere differently from where their high priest used to sit. Their high priest, they were not to sit while serving in the tabernacle or in the temple offering the gifts and the sacrifices. They were to remain standing, meaning that the work that they are doing is not accomplished. And therefore we have a high priest who is seated. Why is he seated? Because he has finished the work that he came to do. He is not going to offer any other sacrifice, because his sacrifice, he offered himself once and for all on our behalf, on behalf of them that the Father gave unto him for salvation, for redemption. And so he's trying to compare, and he's telling them that we have one high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heaven. In verse 2, this high priest is a minister. In other words, he is a servant of the sanctuary. And this sanctuary is a true tabernacle which the Lord has pitched himself, and not man. In the Old Testament, we had this sanctuary or tabernacle which was made by human hands. So Moses was given the architect of this building, and it was the work of Moses to go and assemble the people whom God had given the skills to make this earthly tabernacle. And this earthly tabernacle was to point them to that true and better tabernacle in the heavenly places, where Christ, the true and better high priest, is seated and is interceding on our behalf. A minister of the sanctuary of the true tabernacle with the Lord fish and not man. For every high priest in verse 3 is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices. Wherefore it is of necessity that this man have somewhat also to offer. For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law, who serve unto the example of shadow. So the tabernacle and everything that used to happen in that tabernacle, including the high priest himself, it was in order of the law, according to the law. But all this served as an example, all this served as a shadow of that better thing that we have in Christ Jesus, and that better tabernacle not made by the human hands. In verse 6, but now hath he ordained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. So we have Christ who has obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is a mediator of a better covenant. The old covenant, the mediator was Moses. He was to go, listen what God is saying, and come tell the people of God. So he was the man in between God and men, the congregation, the children of Israel. And now we have Christ who has obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. And we are going to see these better promises. So he is the mediator of this covenant, new covenant, or the New Testament that we have. So when did this new covenant come to be? You remember when Jesus Christ was instituting the Lord's table. He told his disciples that this is for a new what? Covenant. He sealed it with his own blood. At that time he had not died, but he was telling them that a new thing is about to happen. A new dawn is coming, which is going to bring an end of all the Old Testament types and shadows and symbols, because I am who all these have been pointing to. I am the end of the law. I am the end of the earthly tabernacle. I am the end of the earthly sacrificial system. I am the end of the human priesthood system. All these things have served their purpose of bringing you to this new covenant. Have served their purpose of pointing you to the one who is the end of all these practices that you've been holding or practicing. And so, verse 7, for if the first, that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with them, he said, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. So these are words taken from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31, from verse 31 to 34. God was speaking to the nation of Israel through his servant Jeremiah, and he's telling them that I have something new to come. It was not to come during the days of Jeremiah, but it was to come through Christ himself, who is the mediator of this new testament that God promised through the mouth of his servant Jeremiah. And so, I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the days when I took them by the hands to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. You remember when God gave his word, or his law, or his covenant to his servant Moses? There is a time when God told Moses to assemble the congregation of the children of Israel and bring them to the mountain, because I would like to speak to them. When they complained to God, they complained to Moses, that are you the one always to tell us what God is saying? We want also to experience the same. And so we have them being taken by the foot of this mountain, and God, when he spoke, there was thunder, and they fled from the presence of God. And so this fear that was instilled in them was not a perfect fear, because we see them disobeying God and disregarding his word and going back to their former ways. And every time we see God complaining because of the practices of the children of Israel, we see him renewing his covenant again, the Davidic covenant, the same covenant that he made with the children of Israel through Moses, the Mosaic covenant. He's renewing it, reminding them of how they should conduct themselves, how they should behave, Because they had left him, they had departed, and they were doing what was rightful before their own eyes. And so God wants to start another new covenant, which is different from the former. The former covenant was a covenant of works. Yes, God had given them as a means of grace, but it was salvation again of works. If you do, I will do. If you don't do, I will do this. And it instilled fear in them. They lived in fear because it could not save them. And now God tells them that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the days when I took them. In the days when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my law in their mind and write them in their hearts. So this is the better and the new covenant, that Christ Jesus himself is the mediator. And the nature of this covenant, or the promises attached to this covenant, is that I will put my law into their mind and write them in their hearts. The former covenant, the law was written on stone tablets. And we see that Moses had to constantly, and Joshua, remind them of God's word, of which they always deviated from it. And I will put my law in their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God. He promises that he will inscribe his word in our hearts. His word is the law that we are talking about, in our hearts. So he will again be to us a God, and we will be to him a people. Showing how close this covenant is bringing us to God. Because it's not just God who is at a distance, but now he dwells and he lives inside us. His spirit is inside us. And like in the old, under the old covenant, when the spirit of God came upon certain people to help them accomplish certain work. In the new covenant, under the new covenant, which Christ himself is the mediator, we have God living inside us. We have his word inside us. We have God himself mediating between us and God, being our advocate. And another thing is that we see, they shall be to me a people, and they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. The promises that we see, the better promises under the new covenant. I will be merciful to their unrighteousness. So under the old covenant, we see how God visited their transgression. We see them being led to captivity, to bondage. But under this new covenant, God is telling them that I, under the new covenant, it is a language of I. It is God who is doing. Under the old covenant, it is you. You will do. And if you fail, I will do. Under the new covenant, it is all about God. It is a covenant of grace and not a system of works. And therefore, God will be merciful to the transgression, to their transgression, to our transgression. The modern church is living under this new covenant. A covenant that God himself will be merciful to us. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. Under the old covenant, their sins were remembered every time. They had to go to the tabernacle. They had to observe all these sacrificial laws, because that was the only way to cover, to appease the wrath of God, not to remove their sins, because the Old Testament law, the sacrificial system and their practices could not remove even a single sin. But under the New Testament, we have God who is merciful and who is removing their sins and their iniquities, and one who does not remember them. It does not mean that our God, under the New Testament, he has no memory. But the language that he is using is that, I have forgiven you, it is a past thing. I will never remove that old thing and present it as a curse. Under the Old Testament, they had to keep repeating the offering of these sacrifices to appease, because the work of the sacrificial system and the priesthood system was to bring them to the one who is able, to the one who is perfect, to the one who is the end of all these types and shadows being portrayed in the Old Testament. And so we see God will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. For sure, under this new covenant, Christ Jesus ascended upon that bloody hill called Golgotha. And we see him, one who was laid outside that city, the city of David, outside Jerusalem, to be offered on your behalf, on my behalf, and also on behalf of the Old Testament saints. Because even them, by the time they were dying, Christ Jesus had not been offered. So they died under the Old Testament, the old sacrificial system. And now we have Christ Jesus who is come. We have Christ Jesus who has offered himself, him being God himself. In him there is no infirmity. In him we have no blemish or spot. Is the perfect Lamb of God who is come to be offered upon the cross of Calvary to fulfill what the types and the shadows pointed them to. And so, Christ Jesus shows us mercy even in our unrighteousness. He shows us mercy to forgive our sins and our iniquities, and he remembers them no more. No better testament than this. They had no reason to go back to that system of works. They have to reoffer, and there is no solution, there is no forgiveness of sins. The argument here is that we have a better testament under Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus himself being the mediator, being the author of this testament, being the one giving out this testament, and him being God is the one who is seated on the right hand of God the Father, interceding for us. What better testament do we have in Christ Jesus? In that he saying a new covenant, he has made the first old. It was good, but it has accomplished its purpose, and therefore it is time for it to expire. And it expired when Christ Jesus was offered upon the cross of Calvary. And therefore, there is no need for you Jews to go back to the Old Testament sacrificial system, because they pointed you to the one that you are living for presently. And also for us, you must be going through challenges of life, and sometimes you feel like giving up in your Christian walk. This text is here to remind you and to remind us that we have a better person in the person of Christ Jesus. We have a better covenant, testament in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ. There is no reason for you to go back to that old, to that expired system of works. We are under another dispensation of grace, where Christ is telling us that he will show us mercy. He will forgive our sins and our iniquities, and he will remember them no more. You have no reason to live, you know, in the past. It is a new dawn, and things have changed. It has served its purpose of bringing us as a tutor, of pointing us as a schoolmaster to the one who is the end of it. And therefore, we should rejoice, because Christ Jesus, he fulfilled all the types and shadows and symbols of the Old Covenant, of the Old Testament. We have every reason to rejoice. And therefore, as we are leaving this place, remember that we have a better testament, which is living. The previous testament of works, it is dead, it is expired. it has accomplished its purpose. It had no problem. The one who gave this testament, God himself, had no problem. But the people who were given that old covenant, they had no power within themselves to help them keep it to the letter. They were people of infirmities. And therefore, in Christ Jesus, we find this strength even to obey. In Christ Jesus, we find strength even to walk after the fashion of the new man. In Christ Jesus, we have the strength to rely on his power to help us overcome the challenges of this life. Don't dare look back. Christ has fulfilled. Christ has given us this new covenant, the covenant of grace. A better testament than the testament of the old. And therefore, let us remember that God has put his word in our hearts. He has promised that he will be a God to us. He will be a God to us. Is he a God to you individually? We may use the word us and you get lost there. But is he a God to you? Do you know him? Do you know him as an individual? Do you live under this new covenant that him alone is able to dispense to a sinful person? If you have not believed in him for salvation, know that you're not living under the new covenant. It is only the covenant of grace through faith that Christ understands. For the remission of your sins, the other covenant was a covenant of law and works. The new covenant is a covenant of grace and faith, believing in him, the one who has accomplished everything on your behalf. You don't have to be crucified for you to, you know, pay your own sins right. He has done it on your behalf, on our behalf. Are you living under the new dispensation? Are you living under the new covenant? Have you known him? It is my heart's desire that you know him, that he will make himself known to you. Shall we pray? Our good and gracious King, we say thank you because you're good and your mercy is enduring forever. Say thank you because of this day that you've graciously and willingly given unto us, that you may rejoice and live glad in it. Say thank you because of your word, which constantly makes us wise unto salvation, understanding all what you've been doing throughout the history and what you're about to do. Say thank you because of the law that was given through Moses to your people, Israel. We say thank you because of what it was to accomplish and it has accomplished. Say thank you because of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the end of all Old Testament practices and shadows and types. Say thank you because of this better and living covenant that he is the mediator of. We say thank you because of these better promises that are attached to this new covenant we are having this day. Lord Jesus, we say thank you because of dying for us. We say thank you because of offering yourself upon that bloody hill, bearing us in your mind. We say thank you because of ascending upon that hill willingly without being pushed by anyone. We thank you because of paying for the sinner's price. We say thank you because of transforming us. A God who art in heaven, we say thank you because you have done everything on our behalf, that we don't have to pay our sinner's debt ourselves. Thank you for doing it on our behalf. Lord, who art in heaven, may you help us to understand that we are living under new dispensation, and it is a dispensation of you doing everything on our behalf. May you help us to wholly trust in you for strength to trust and to obey your word, for this is the greatest and noble thing that you called us to do. Lord, who art in heaven, I know in our midst there are people who are struggling with diverse temptations and struggles of life. Others are thinking of giving up even in this faith that they are in. Just like these Jewish Christians who are frustrated because of persecution and difficulties of life, we pray, and I pray, that you will encourage one and you will constantly remind them of this better testament that they have in you, that they don't have to go back to their old religious systems, to their old practices when they were in the world. Oh God, who art in heaven, may you help them to surrender their lives unto you. May you help them that they may cling to this cross where Jesus died and he paid this sinner's debt on their behalf. Oh Lord, who art in heaven, may you strengthen us that the inner man might be nourished of you, that we may find strength even to continue in our Christian walk. Lord, who art in heaven, may you give us strength even to share this noble news with others who are struggling, and to encourage them to hold on in faith, knowing that there is a day when you will come and it will bring and mark an end of all struggles and of all problems and sufferings of this life. Lord, who art in heaven, may you help us to look forward to that blessed hope, to that imminent return of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, who art in heaven, we ask that you may help us to be ready for that return, for that coming, that when you come for your people, we shall be counted among the number. Lord, who art in heaven, may you help us even in our sins, may you help us in our struggles, that we may overcome. May you be our strength this day. And even for this week that has just begun, we ask that you may use us as instruments of blessings, that you may bless our loved ones, our friends, our parents, our brothers and sisters, and the community around us, that you may impact it with the knowledge and with the good news of our loving Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Our God who art in heaven, may you forgive us of our sinfulness, and even as we leave this place to our homes, to our different places, may you bless and may you lead us even in this week that has started today. For Jesus Christ's name we pray.